On slide 24, but I just wanted to start here, and this is like just to remind you what GSM is. We are going to talk about GSM more today. And what GSM did was it added to the previous FDMA time TDMA as well. So each channel now can carry multiple users. Okay, on each frequency, users have a turn, right? So this is how it is done basically, is that there are what we call multi-frame, which is 120 millisecond long. So continuously the time is divided into 120 millisecond. Every 120 millisecond something repeats. Okay. Multi-frame is divided into 26 frames. And each frame is basically 120 upon 26 millisecond long. Okay. And so these TDMA frames are also called bursts. So, and each burst is 120 divided by 26 milliseconds, okay? And then each burst has so many bits. Actually, I don't know, I haven't added this right now at this minute, but there are 3 bits for the trail, tail, 57 bits for the data, 1 bit for stealing, and so on and so forth. And you can add all this number and you will come up with something 0.25 number of bits in the burst. Okay. Now each burst is a user. So on each frequency, this pattern is repeated. And so each pattern, each one can carry up to these many users. I think the number of users has to be 24. So since there are 26 here, 2 of the bursts are for something else. Okay, the last one is unused, so that is gone, and that leaves 25, but then we only need 24 users per frequency. Number 12? Yeah, right, okay, all right, good. Okay, so number 12 is gone, so you have 24 users. And this is for historical reasons. Because when the original telephone system was designed for wired networks, they took 24 users and then made one line called T1 line for transmission. So each T1 line has 24 users. So now here, even though there is no T1, 24 users are combined. Yeah. Yeah, it's just a time. It's just a time, it's not a bit. Bit time. Right? So, yeah, see, the thing is, some of these times, 120 millisecond, and 26 doesn't even divide into 120 millisecond. It would be nice if it was some point of integer. But these times came from the wired network. Right? The whole telephone system is synchronous, as they call it. Synchronous is driven on a clock. Everybody's clock is very much, you know, aligned. So you do it particularly. So if you want to connect wireless to wired, you need to run on that wired clock. And so now let's see. So we found that there are 24 users in every 120 millisecond. And then each user can transmit so many training bits, so many stealing bits, and so on and so forth. And I will explain the meaning of all of these. But on this slide, we see that there is something called slow associated control channel, SACCH. And so that is a control channel that doesn't belong to any user, but that is the user, that is the one that is used by the base station to do some things on the network. right? So for example, if I want to tell you, if the base station wants to tell a phone that please use slot number 13 on frequency number 14, right? That is the control channel will be used for that purpose. So control channel is for controlling the network. It is not something that you can speak on, but the base station can speak on. All right. So, more details. It's moving by itself again. So, as we said, coming back from the original days, that there was a downlink and there was an uplink and there were different frequencies, right? And separated by 45 megahertz. So the uplink is 890 to 915, and you add 45 to that and you get 935 to 960 for downlink. So when you get something, you know, you get both ways. You're receiving and transmitting. You're speaking and listening at the same time. 25 megahertz, because this is total thing is 25 megahertz, that is divided into 125 200 kilohertz frequency channels. So on the frequency domain, there are 125 channels on the frequency domain, and we are going to divide each channel into 24 users, right? And each frequency channel is, each frequency channel is TDMA with a burst period of 15 by 26 milliseconds, as we saw there before in the previous slide. 8 burst period make a TDMA frame. And one user traffic channel is one burst period. And 26 TDMA frame with multi-frame. So let me just say it here. Okay, so I did say one thing wrong. These are not 24 users. Users are these. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 3, 6, 8. 8 users make 1, and then 24 times 8 make 1 channel, 1 frequency channel. Yeah.
So at each channel, we have 8 multiplied by 26 users?
24. 20. Yeah. So the thing is, basically, there are 26 here, but 2 of them are for something else, and 24, yeah. All right, and so this is each user. Each user gets a burst, which is called a slot, and a slot is so long. It happens to be something dot 2.25 bit time. Of course, you cannot transmit 0.25 bits, so you just leave that time alone. All right, so back to this. I got to remove that timing. Okay, so each 8 burst period, and so one user is one burst. 26 TDMA frame make one multi-frame. 24 are used for traffic, one for control, and one is used. The control is called SAACH. And if SAACH is not sufficient capacity, fast associated channel is used by stealing half of some burst. Now, let me explain you that. Sometimes you need more control traffic, then it can go in one channel. If you need more, then you steal it from the users. Okay? And so there are 2 bits in the user thing which are reserved for this purpose. Okay? And so there are 2 bits. Those can be stolen for the control. Remember, data is everything that is sent by the user, right? But there are 2 control bits which have been put in. So that is called fast associated control channel, FACCH. Stealing bits identify whether half a slot carries data or control. So those 2 bits are not just the stolen bits. Those indicate that I have taken half your slot. Okay. there. So if you're not speaking, I can steal your bits. So those bits will indicate, you know, how I have stolen your data bits for control purposes. And then 200 kilohertz here equal to 270.8 kilobits. Okay, how do you get 278 kilobits? By using a particular modulation technique, you can convert hertz to bits. And the modulation technique was fixed in this initial version. So it was very easy. So let's say they selected QPSK or whatever. I mean, this actually they didn't select QPSK. Whatever, then you know how many bits per hertz you get. So you get that number, 270. That is divided into 8 slots. Each slot is 34 kilobits. And then you get 156.25 bits per slot. So there is 0.25. And by the time you have taken the 34, by the time you have taken care of the encryption and the FEC, so for each bit, we put lots of FEC bits, you get 9.6 kilobits per user. Fifteen by 26 milliseconds.
Yeah.
What is that?
Yeah.
Okay. So keep dividing here. If you divide 120, you get 120 by 26 for each burst. Then you divide by 8. Right? Then you get 120 by 8 is 15 by 26 for each burst. It's just a straight division. It just happens to be that number. The thing is, the time came from the old days. Right? So they don't have control over that part. Alright. So if you were sending data, you will get 9.6 kilobits per slot per user. That's the maximum the user can transmit in GSM. Right? Now it looks like nothing, given that we talk about gigabits and kilobits and megabits. This is 9.6 kilobits. So, what happens to the voice? Voice is the usual 64 kilobits. So basically, I mean, not yet. So 64 kilobit is the voice that you do on the wire. On the wire, what you do is you take your voice and you sample it every, I mean, basically 8 kilo times, 8,000 times per second, and each sample becomes 8 bit. Right? So you get 64,000 bits per second. So that is what 64 kilobits is. Now, on wireless, we cannot have that much. So they compress it to 16 kilobits. And that's all this basically you need to know. So when you do data, you get 9.6 because there is so much correction if stuff bits used. But for voice, you can use, you can get 16 kilobits because, so you have 34 kilobits, but you can send 16 kilobit voice through that because there's less correction. In the voice, if I say A and you heard E, not a big deal. On the data, if I said A and you heard E, you know, that would make millions of dollars difference. So you can send 16 kilobit voice or 9.6 kilobit data. So the rest of this stuff on this slide simply says that the SIM contains, we already said that the SIM contains information about authentication, encryption, and accounting. And you can have your 4-digit PIN to lock the SIM. And the SIM cards can contain additional information such as emergency medical information, And so then there is this mobile assisted handoff. So what that means is when the mobile can listen to multiple towers, it can tell the network that, look, I am listening to the tower 1, 5, and 7, and so on and so forth. And then the network can decide which tower you should and go to. Right? That is called mobile assisted handoff. The other side is network initiated handoff, where the network knows where you are and which tower you should go to without your telling, right? So there are both possibilities, but here it is mobile assisted handoff. And then they thought about that if there is no control traffic, what do we do with the control channel? So the control channel is, so they said that on the control channel, we can send a very short message. Any user can send a very short message. Right? You don't need to say, well, I want to make call, this and that. You just send the message, you're done. And you do this on the control channel. You see how the control and the data are getting intermixed here. Previously, the control was very separate from data in the telephone network. But now, they are using control channel for data. And they are using data channel for control. Right? So that is how SMS was born. SMS basically came out as a free thing to the carrier, free to the carrier, because they didn't have to put a new infrastructure. They already have the control channel, but they're allowing you to use it. Okay? So they started SMS, and it became so famous that I'm sure that now instead of one control channel, you'll probably use 20 control channels just for SMS. But in the beginning, it was just one control channel where, you know, they just allowed users to send up to a very small message, up to 160 characters. And that message could be unicast or broadcast. I haven't seen a broadcast SMS, but theoretically that exists. So now we do some math on this. And so let's see. We have a cellular system. It has a cluster size of 7. So if you divide the area into hex things, remember the cluster size 7, repeat 7, 7, 7, 7 everywhere. That's the cluster size. User density is 100 users per square kilometer. Allocated frequency spectrum is 50, 900 to 949, 49 megahertz. Bit rate required per user is 10 kilobits per second uplink and 10 kilobits per second downlink, and modulation produces 1 bits per hertz. So these are numbers that, you know, are example numbers. They are not real numbers. These are example numbers. Now you are in the beginning of designing the GSM kind of stuff. So you should know as to how they designed it. So now using FDMA, how much bandwidth is available per cell using FDD? So if you are not doing GSM, you are doing the old one, the 1G, then you are giving the whole frequency channel to each user, right? How many bandwidth is available per cell? How many users per cell can be supported using FDMA? What is the cell area? What is the cell radius? So all of this, you know, basically we will solve one by one. The other question is, if the available spectrum is divided into 35 channels and TDMA is applied within each channel, so instead of whatever we talked about, 24, let's say 35 channels, what is the bandwidth and data rate per channel? So this is all straight division in some sense, but we just want to go through that. Okay. So here's the thing. How much bandwidth is available per cell? So you have 49 megahertz, and there are 7 cells. So you have to divide that into 7. 7 megahertz per cell. If you're going to use FDD, then you will use 3.5 for uplink and 3.5 for downlink. Now, you have to differentiate between FDD and FDMA. All right? What is FDD? It's duplexing method. Duplexing method means that how do you do up and down? Okay? It could be TDD or FDD. FDD means you go down on one frequency and go up on the other frequency. TDD means that you go down on the same frequency and go up on the same frequency using time. TDDMA. What is FDMA? What is TDMA? FDMA is that basically 25 users are going to use, how they are going to share by frequency. TDMA by time. Right? So don't confuse between FDD and FDMA. Clear to everybody? Alright. So, using FDMA plus FDD. So, it says using FDMA slash FDD. So, because of FDD, it becomes half. If it was not FDD, it would remain same, right? So, you get 3.5 megahertz. How many users per cell can be supported using FDMA? So, now, if you have 10 kilobits per user and you're getting 1 bits per hertz, you need 10 kilohertz. And with 3.5 megahertz, you can support up to 350 users per cell. Yeah. Okay, first of all, do you understand how did we got 10 kilohertz?
Yes, it's 150 a second.
Right, and you understand how we got 3.5 megahertz?
I think 3.5 would be 55.
So if you divide this into that, you get 350. 3.5 megahertz divided by 10 kilohertz is 350. Everybody got that? I should have put that here, 3.5 divided by 10. But anyway, 350. What is the cell area? Since there are 100 users per square kilometer, so now to support 350, we need 3.5 square kilometers per cell. And therefore, the cell radius can be calculated to be 1 kilometer. Yeah. 3.5 square kilometer per cell. Okay, because we told you that there are 100 users per square kilometer. Right? And now one tower can support 350 users. Right? One tower can support 350 users and 100 users live in 1 square kilometer. So that is 3.5 square kilometer. Okay. If there's no, I mean, basically this is a question which is in the homework. And this is a question which I have to ask in the exam because there was so much, there's only so much mathematics in this course. Right? So you should understand everything very clearly. If it is not clear, ask right now. And it's all very simple division, except you have to know what to divide by what and when. So there are 3.5 square kilometer. That means that the each cell has a radius of 1 kilometer. Pi r squared is 3.5. Right? So there is a square root there. But other than that, you know, it's just very simple math. Now, part B. If the available spectrum is divided into 35 channels, and TDMA is employed within each channel, what is the bandwidth and data rate per channel? Okay, so now you have to differentiate between the user and the channel, just like we did there. There was a multi-frame, a frame, and a burst. Right? So first, right now, we are talking about these channels, 35 frequency channels. So since there are 3.5 megahertz and we're dividing into 35, each of them is 100 kilohertz per channel, which is giving 100 kilobits per channel. How many slots are needed in a TDMA frame to require number of users? So now each user needs 10 kilobits and you are getting 100 kilobits. So in each channel, you can put only 10 users. Yeah. 3.5 is already the half.
I mean, we have 5.5 users, personal and external, for example.
Yeah, if for example, it becomes 3.5, I mean, you know, then you just use 3 users. I mean, you know, the thing is, this is just teaching you the method, and then you use your common sense when you're designing in the real world. Of course, you would not say, well, I will support 3.5 users. And like here, you know, they had 157.25 bits what do you do with that? They just leave that 0.25 bits alone, right? So same thing. Yeah, if you get fractional answers, then just don't be aggressive. Yeah. FDD. Okay, so this one assumes FDD somehow. So you think it doesn't say FDD here, but it assumes that whatever calculation did here. So first, what we did was we divided the spectrum into FDMA, and then in each FD, we are going to do TDMA. Right? That's how GSM is. That whatever spectrum you are given, in 1G, you divided that into FDMA. In 2G, each frequency is divided into TDMA. Right? So this 49 by 7 and 7 by 2 was already done in this part. 3.5 per channel. Now that 3.5 became 100 kilobits divided by 35. And 100 kilobits became 10 users.
Okay.
Yeah.
From 1000 kilohertz per cell, we just got it 100 kilobits per cell.
Yeah, because we have 1 hertz per bit. Right, that was specified somewhere. 1 hertz per bit.
That's the first part. Like 1 bit per second.
Yeah, per hertz. No, see, thing is here. Yeah, 1 bit per hertz.
The second equation will be doing a division or multiplication with 100 kilohertz.
Oh, just think about it. So let's say you get 2 bits per hertz. I mean, the right way to say is 2 bits per second per hertz, BPS per hertz, right? If you're getting 2 bits per hertz, 100 kilohertz will become how much? 200, yes. You got it. All right, and today you can do 256 QAM, which gives you 256 is 2 raised to 8, is right? 8 bits per hertz. So, you know, but this is very old days, right? So it's 1 bit per hertz. So now, those 10 kilobits per hertz means that you can have 10 users on each channel using TDMA. If the TDMA frame is 10 milliseconds, how long is the each slot? So you take that 10 millisecond slot, and there are 10 users, so each user gets 1 millisecond. Right? So now your burst size. How many bits are transmitted in each time slot? So 1 millisecond by 100 would be 100 milliseconds. So basically, what we have done is, these are the real numbers that they finally ended up. But I've just told you how they calculated all this, because they, at that time, they, everything was variable and possible. And so now you can, these numbers are now fixed. Right? But if you were designing your own GSM version 3, then you will, this is how you do it. All right? So, let's go back to this set of questions. Any question about this? So these are just the questions. This is just the answers. And then there's this as the homework. Basically line for line. Is there any line that you need to understand now? Okay? Yeah?
Will the homework 15 see the day next Monday?
Next Monday, yeah.
Just see or
yeah. As it comes through. I don't know. I mean, I haven't seen. The thing is, whenever it comes up, it is due on next Monday. GPRS. So this is 2G, and this is an innovation over the previous technology. Everybody is happy, but soon they become unhappy because 9.6 kilobit is no good. The data capacity is too low. Right? So the work begins on the next generation, which is called GP. Actually, not next generation, sorry. Next evolution. Okay? And it's not 2G to 3G, it is just 2 point something, okay? So they call it GPRS, 2.5G. And so 9.6 is not good. So they said, let's do more. And the more is called GPRS. And here is the trick. Instead of giving one slot to the user, like we saw before, we can give multiple slots. And four different codings used depending upon the channel condition. And then now we learned that we don't have to give everybody the same coding. So if you are near, we can give you 2 bits per hertz. If you are far, we can give you 1 bits per hertz and so on. GPRS is second thing, right? Is that different coding, 4 different codings. And then we can give you many slots. Third, fourth, you can hop onto many channels. Oh, here is GP1. GP1 is the GPRS user 1. It was here, it moved there, it moved there, it moved there, it moved there, GP1. It is just hopping. Wherever there is nobody talking, we can send data. Yeah. Like Bluetooth? No. No, no, this is not a random number generator here. It is an assigned number. So basically, here the channel says that, okay, that slot is empty, go to that slot. Okay, it's not a random hopping, eh?
There is a control
that's... Yeah, that slow control channel and that fast control channel will tell you where to go. So this is not a random number generation, and this is basically slot by slot. So there are 4 things which are happening. One is that we have better codings. We have up to 8 slots. We can give you 1, 2, 3, up to 8 slots. And we can, and then you can hop, you know, here and there. And of course, still the voice is the key. So no voice user is interrupted. So the voice users don't even know that their slots are being stolen. Right? But now the data is being sent over the time and they're not speaking, which is 50% of the time. Right? If you're on the phone, if you speak more than 50%, then you know you're not letting the other guy speak. So you speak generally 50% of the time and you listen 50% of the time. So half of the channel is empty in either direction, up and down. Yeah.
Can you just switch between the GSM and GPRS?
So GPRS is basically an enhancement to GSM. GSM is all going on. So this is a GSM user, G1, G1, G1. Every 8th slot, G1 comes back. Right? G2 is a GSM user. Every 8th slot, it comes back. It is talking. And maybe it is sending data, doesn't matter, really. But it is coming every 8th slot. Right? Fixed coding. Fixed slot position, fixed number of slots, no frequency hopping, nothing. The GPRS gives you much better data. Now you can do up to 171 kilobits. Yeah.
No, I mean the G1 and GP1, they are the same users?
No. G1 is the GSM user 1, GP1 is the GPRS user 1. You would. I mean, like, basically, if you have GSM with a GPRS service and GPRS phone, then if you want to send data, then you are using GSM for voice, and suddenly you say, I want to send data, and then you switch to GP1. I mean, if you wanted to, but it doesn't have to be. Right? So you would switch if your phone and this tower both are capable of GPRS. Your phone will show you. I think sometimes it shows GPRS, and I don't know. It shows E, which is coming up later on. E is enhanced evolution of GPRS. Okay? Yeah. Huh? E comes up, right?
And G,
GPRS comes back. Yeah, okay, all right. So now you see from GSM, we move to GPRS. And everybody understand GPRS is only for data. I mean, you're not going to talk any more faster than 64 kilobit. So there you are all set. Speaking is all set. The voice is all handled by GSM. It's the data which is the problem. Yeah.
So if I'm browsing a bar for that gigahertz as well, 10 or 50 gigahertz, what I can do is like all the one.
When you're not using it?
When I'm using the browse.
Yeah, then you're using GPRS.
So when it is a call coming now, I then be calling.
Yeah, so you might be using both. So thing is, here thing. GSM part and GPRS parts are independent. Like, see, ask the question, right? Whether G1 is same as GP1, they could be same, they could be different. Right? I mean, it's your phone company's policy, which generally you would say that they will keep you happy. You know, I mean, they would not just disconnect your file transfer suddenly. Your file transfer is going on GPRS, and then a phone call comes, you can talk. On G1. Okay, so. Okay. All right, but I mean, you can see, I mean, this is basically GPRS is only for data. And GSM is for data and voice, but the data is so slow that if you have GPRS, you will use GPRS. So the things that made GPRS again, one more time, are the coding, number of slots, and the number of channels. Now you can have the channels. Support intermittent and busty data transfers. Point to multipoint is also supported. And so basically you can have the data which is multipoint. Need to add two new elements to the GSM network. So now the network has to change. All right. And so the previous picture that we showed you, this picture is for GSM. It doesn't have anywhere the things that we need for GPRS. So two new boxes will be added to this picture. Those boxes are called SGSN and GGSN. SGSN is Service GPRS Support Node, and GGSN is Gateway GPRS Support Node, and Service includes Security, Mobility, Access Control, and Gateway includes just the data plane. So basically, this could be called the data plane and the control plane. Basically, the thing is, the data is coming through the gateway, and everything else is coming through the service, SGSN and GGSN. Now, these two acronyms, SGSN and GGSN, you should just memorize them, because they're used so often in the phone world, and then you're thinking, what is SGSN? You know, it's Service GPRS Support Node. Even today, with LTE and everything else, you will see this SGSN, GGSN, et cetera, coming in, because these things have not gone out. Well, the new things have come in, so the world is becoming very complex. But anyway, so now I introduce two new words to you, which are GGSN and SGSN. And this is how they look like in the picture. In the previous picture, if you have data from BSC, it is stored straight away goes to PCU, packet control unit. From packet control unit, it goes to SGSN and GGSN, and then goes to the internet. I have put one more new box here, which I just noticed. SS7 network here. Right? So you remember the ME mobile MDP or whatever we call it before, BTS, BSC, MSC, visitor, horizontal, everything else. And it says SS7 network and public switch telephone network. SS7 is signaling system 7, which is the basically the system for the wired networks control traffic. Basically, when you make a phone call on the wired network, your signaling goes to SS7. Okay? Obviously, SS7 means it is seventh generation of something, but that is what is used. Okay? So that is the control plane for the wired traffic. This is the public switch telephone network, the data plane. Anyway, so basically, so this is all the old picture, and to that picture, we have added these boxes. So the data traffic goes via these three boxes to the internet. All right, now that the GPRS is not good enough, we go further to the next evolution, and that is called edge. Yeah.
Could you remind me the difference between evolution and generation?
Evolution is the European for generation, next generation. Okay, hold on. So basically, when we say 1G, 2G, 3G, those are generations. Evolution is, there is no word. Basically evolution is, step, enhancement. But somehow in the telephony world, they use evolution so often that I just think, we don't use evolution that often in the rest of the world. You don't say, this thing, whatever that box is, and then this is evolution of that box. That doesn't sound like good English to me, right? But that's what they say. Evolution. So evolution of GSM is edge. Edge is enhanced data rate for GSM evolution. Now, so edge can give you better than GPRS. GPRS basically, so here I think, edge plus GPRS can give you up to 384 kilobits. So we were up to 100, up to 171 or something. Now we are better. How? So standard GSM uses this particular modulation, Gaussian minimum shift keying modulation. Minimum shift keying modulation. Now, I had a slide on Gaussian minimum shift keying modulation, but it's really not relevant. All you have to know is this is a modulation right now. Just another, QPSK or whatever you want to call it. Gaussian means normal distribution. So somehow, they, instead of having pulses which are square, they make it Gaussian. All right. So that modulation and the data stream is shaped with a Gaussian filter. That's what this means. Yeah. The data stream is shaped with a Gaussian filter before frequency modulation. So anyway, as it changes to 8 PSK, so instead of one, whatever number of bits, I think it was 1 bit per hertz, now you get 3 bits per hertz. This was already done in GPRS, where we had 4 different modulation. Now in the edge, they have this super modulation, which gives you 3 bits per hertz. So now you get 384 kilobits. And to be able to do this 3 bits per hertz, you really need a good signal quality. And so now everything has to have the word edge into it, because all these boxes that you had, now they have to have the word edge into it if they support edge. Like these boxes were designed for GSM. Then we added GPRS, so we had to add 3 boxes there. Now we are going to have edge, so there is something else. In particular, this particular square, which was called RAN, Radio Access Network, is now called GERAN. GERAN is the GSM Edge Radio Access Network. Why? Because if you are not GERAN compliant, you would not be able to understand 3 bits per hertz. Right? So most of the tower may not be on the day one be GERAN compliant. This is the radio access network, right? That the whole analog the part has been changed. So now the RAN is called GERAN. Yeah.
The line GPRS plus 8384.
Can I do what? Explain?
Yeah.
Okay. So if you remember here, depending upon how many slots you got, you could go from 76 to 171 kilobits. Right? Yeah. And with edge, you can go up to 384 kilobits. And it doesn't sound like that much of an improvement over 171. 171 and 384 may be a factor of 2. It doesn't sound like that much improvement, 2.5, whatever. But the thing is, here in the edge, you get 3 times more than GSM right away. GSM was 9.6 kilobits, and you get 3 times more because of the modulation, right? And then little bit of hopping and this and that gives you some more.
I mean, this plus sign means that if we use both
Yeah, you use both. Yeah, GPS and edge. Okay. All right. So much about 2.5G. So 2.5G was basically edge. And it's still there. I mean, I still get E on my phone often. Okay, you are in some remote area and it says E. If you go to foreign country in particular, you might get an E. Has anybody else got an E? Right? Okay, so that is edge. Yeah, so sometimes it's GPS and it depends upon how much they have improved their towers. You see, for edge, you need a new radio.
But why I have something like
three and
three slow.
And? I feel the internet speed is really slow. Yeah. Both of them are slow. See, thing is, now that you're used to 3G, 4G, and 5G, I mean, you know, these things are, you know, I mean, they are slow by definition. But they are just surviving in the sense that if you get an E, at least you can send some data. If you don't get that E, you know, you will click something, you'll put A, and then it will take some time for the character to go there and get a code. That would really be slow then. Then you will know how people lived. Okay. All right. So now we go to 3G. 3G is called WCDMA. Okay. Wideband Code Division Multiple Access. This is the European 3G. If you remember the chart that we had, there were two 3G branches. One was American and one was European. European is 3GPP. American is 3GPP2. There are two organizations. So the European went for wide band, and it will be clear in a minute what is wide band. Basically, if you are given 5 megahertz, you use this band. And in the America, they just divided into pieces. So they didn't use this wide band. So here it is wide band. Also known as Universal Mobile Telecommunication System, or UMTS. Now this whole telephony field is filled with acronyms. And if you read any book, they're just filled with these words. And so you get used to this UMTS, UTRAN, RAN, GRAN. So UMTS, another word you should know, is nothing but WCDMA. Okay? WCDMA is the coding. UMTS is the real name of the system. Uses direct sequence spread spectrum over 2.5 megahertz FDD channels. So 5 megahertz down, 5 megahertz up, that is FDD, right? The whole 5 megahertz is shared by all the users using CDMA. Eh? No, not TDD, sorry, CDMA. No TDD. Whole 5 megahertz is shared by code division multiple access, where everybody has a different code. Remember this CDMA we talked about, and that code is direct sequence split spectrum, where you take your one bit and make 11 chips out of it. I don't know whatever number of chips, I don't know exactly how many here, but you, instead of one bit, you send a code. And now the radio access network, that was called RAN first, then it was called GERAN, now it is called UMTS, Terrestrial Radio Access Network, UTRAN. Yeah. It's there today. Yeah, when you get 3G, you get UTRAN. That's what you're doing.
I think for the LTE.
LTE is not 3G. No, LTE is 3.9G, so that will come later. So this is, and LTE is not even CDMA, by the way. So just hold on to thought of LTE. This is 3G. And so in 3G, I'm just going to give you some buzzwords. And too bad it is buzzwords only, because this is all old history. If we teach you old history, we don't have time for the new history. So I'm going to concentrate on the new history a little bit more detail when we come to LTE and LTE Advanced and 5G. This is just you need to get by with it. Right? There's no new development in this. So when you hear the word UMTS, you know that they're talking about 3G. And when you hear the word UTRAN, you know that they're talking about the radio access network. Right? And the interface itself is called UTRA, air interface. All right. So the whole system is UTRAN, the radio access network, and the air interface is UTRA, terrestrial radio access, UTRA. And they change the names of everything. So the user, which was mobile, something mobile station, MS, before, is now called user element, UE. The base station, which was called BSC or something, no, base station, BTS, is now called node B. B is for base station. Node B. And the radio network controller name, luckily they didn't change, and they didn't change MSC. So now you will hear a lot of node Bs and UEs. Alright, when we say UE, it is the same thing as mobile station, MS, or mobile, whatever ME we call it before. And so these are the users. Node B is the base station. So this is 3G. Now, this is all I'm going to tell about 3G. Believe it or not, we don't need to know more than this, because this is all history. Alright, this is already 10 years ago. So we go into the next one, which is 3.5G, which is HSPA. So just like GSM became GPRS, WCDMA now has this HSPA, which is evolution of WCDMA. Right? And HSPA stands for High Speed Packet Access, which has two parts, high speed downlink and high speed uplink. And they came in two phases. Alright? So HSDPA and HSUPA. They didn't come together. They came piece by piece. By the way, for the phone company, it takes a very long time to implement any of these changes. You know why? Because they have 10,000 towers and you just go to and tell them, look like we got HSDPA. I say, hold on, it will take 10 years. We have to, you know, send people to these towers and change this new equipment and all that. So they move very slowly. I mean, I have a cartoon which shows they are elephants. Right? I mean, they're not like horses like we are. You know, the thing is, the enterprise networking industry, Ethernet guys, we run, you know, we just have, last year we had 1 gigabit, this year we have 10 gigabit, next year we'll have 100 gigabit, next year, you don't even know what is right now, 400 gigabit is there. Okay? So I'm just saying that, you know, they're running, right? But the telephone company, they're elephants.
It costs money
and it's infrastructure. Thing is, it's like roads, you know, roads cannot become, you know, from 1 gigabit to 10 gigabit next day, right? It will take, you know, a few years before the roads will become 10 lanes. So that's what it is infrastructure. So anyway, HSDPA and HSUPA. What is HSDPA? Nothing but more of the same. Basically, adaptive modulation encoding, channel dependent scheduling. So this is a new thing. If your channel is good, we give you a different scheduling, which includes the modulation and the timing and everything else, depending on then the channel to somebody else. Okay? Previously, everybody had the same coding. Everybody had the same thing, right? So now from that, we are moving to channel dependent scheduling. And high order modulation. Now we know that there is more than, you know, GMSK. There is 16 QAM. All right, high order modulation. We can take, you know, more bits per hertz. And so you can do it uplink and downlink. And all the way up to 64 QAM is HSPA. And now you can do up to 168 megabits down and 22 megabits up using MIMO and multiple carriers. HSPF plus actually, HSPF plus. So there's an evaluation of HSPF, which is HSPF plus. Okay, so these came in three steps. First, HSDPA, then HSUPA, the combined became HSPA, and then HSPA plus. Okay, so all of these things that, you know, sound so trivial, MIMO and, you know, 16 QAM and all that, they made up 3.5G. Okay. And now the picture becomes very complicated because while 3.5G is there, 2G has not gone away. So when you get a phone which does, let's say, 3G, it is also doing 2G. Luckily, it is not doing 1G anymore. But it is doing 2G, 2.5G, 2.9G, everything else that was ever introduced has to be done because you might run into a tower which is still at that age. Right? So the network looks like this. You see, we have three different RANs. You have GE RAN, UTRAN. Well, I have introduced here something, one thing extra, which is LTE. It is EUTRAN. I haven't gotten to that yet. But basically, you see, and then we have these node B is instead of BTS, and that node B, as we get to LTE, it will be called ENB. All right? Now, node B will become evolved node B. Right? And so it will be called ENB. And we have SGSN, GGSN, SS7, all of those. Yeah. UE is? Okay, yeah. Good correction. So on this slide, the first UE should be MS or ME. I forget what it was. Something like that. It was mobile something. Huh? MS, yeah. Not UE. And you notice that BSC is called RNC, Radio Network Controller, and it is gone in this box. So these boxes are all happening, and unfortunately, they're all happening on every tower, right, at the same time. So you cannot just say that I have 4G and not 3G. And that's why the telephone calls are so expensive. The whole telecommunication is so expensive. Because they have all these boxes which are very specialized and they are age old. So actually this picture shows 3.9G LTE. But we have talked about so far only about 3.5G, which is HSPA plus. Right? So the next module, when we get into that module, we will talk about LTE. Right, and we will go into more detail of each of these things. I mean, more of detail of these boxes. Right now on 3G, I'm just skipping most of it, giving you just the buzzwords so that you know that if you read somewhere, you know what they are. And if you really need to, if you happen to work for a phone company, of course, you will take a whole course on 3G and read a whole book on 3G. But right now, it's not worth it. So here are all the acronyms, and let's just see if any one of them we didn't introduce. CS is circuit switched. EPC is evolved packet core, evolved packet system, GE RAN, SGSN, LTE, mobile management utility, MME. Actually, it should be entity. MME is right here. So I haven't introduced you yet. This will come back later. Mobile management. All it's saying is handover management, mobile management entity. And I haven't introduced SGW and 3GW. These are all in the next module. So MSC, Mobile Switching Center, was there before. Packet switched. We know radio network control and SG, SN, SS7, ENB. Everything we have done except for the 3.9G part. All right. So that brings us to the end of this 1 to 3G. And six key things. first thing we learned is that if the cluster size is n, then there is a distance that we can calculate between the cells of the same frequency. And that formula is D is equal to R square root of 3n, where R is the cell radius, n is the cluster size, and D is the distance between the centers of the cells. Right? Then 1G was analog wise with FDMA. And then TDMA came up with 2G. And is most widely implemented standard 2G, GSM. And then GSM was not good for data, so they put GPRS and Edge. 3G was with CDMA, WCDMA. Actually, I left half of 3G. Let me just tell you what I left. I left you the American 3G. Okay? So they have another version of CDMA, and they have another version of HSPA, and other version of HSPA Plus. I don't know why I left it. I think the reason I left it because that is so limited, you know, actually just to United States, and also it is going away. The United States is adopting all these European things now. So the good thing is that the 3.9G onwards, the whole world is one. So LTE, there is only one standard. Okay. So anyway, so here there is 3G. 3G was CDMA, and WCDMA had 5 megahertz channels. And the American version is not called WCDMA, it is called CDMA 2000. That divided first into frequency and then did the CDMA on that. Okay, so it's not wide band, it is narrow band. Data rate was improved later using HSP and HSPA Plus. And 3.9G and 4G is high speed data with OFDMA. And so all that is actually coming in the next module. Any question about this 1 to 3G? All right. So these are the two books which are online. And for reading, lots of Wikipedia and things like that. That's all.